Morning, take your Bibles, please, and turn to the second book of Corinthians, chapter 4. 2 Corinthians, chapter 4. We'll be reading together this morning, verses 16 through 18. 2 Corinthians, chapter 4, verses 16 through 18. In honor of God's inspired, infallible, inerrant, and unchangeable word, will you stand with me as we read together God's word? 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 16 through 18. Paul writes, "Therefore, we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal." Let's pray. Father, we thank you again for your word. Thank you, Father, that we have the opportunity, as it were, to obey your command, to set aside this first day of the new week for the purpose of worship, instruction, fellowship, and evangelism. We've come this morning to hear from you. God, we long to hear your voice. We long for your instruction. We long for your encouragement and sense of hope. So, Father, I pray today at First Baptist you find teachable spirits. So, Lord, again, we thank you for this opportunity to gather this morning to worship you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. You can be seated. One of the most emotionally challenging experiences in the life of any church is the change of pastoral leadership. So what do I say this morning to First Baptist Church of Troy? A church in transition, a church with an unknown future. I am absolutely convinced that God laid upon my heart a very special message for First Baptist Church during this transition period. And so I want to look at God's Word. What does God's Word say about a church that is going through this moment of transition, of change? Now let's clarify something from the very beginning. No one likes change. Whether it's a pastor resigning or a new pastor coming, whether it's a new strategy, a new location, nobody likes change. It could be a sudden death, it could be a disaster, it could be a pink slip from your boss. Listen to me, no one likes change. That is, except a baby with a dirty diaper. No one likes change. Dan and I are going through a particular point in our lives where once again, we sold everything we owned, moved from Japan, came back to North Carolina, to a new ministry in a new position, something I've never done before, just experienced a few weeks ago, the birth of our 9th grandchild, and have embarked on the construction of a new home. No one likes change. And I believe there are many of you this morning that are going to experience change over the next year. Incredible change. And change is all around us. And I have found myself here over the last 2 months, 3 months, praying something like this. Lord, this change doesn't catch you by surprise. In your sovereign grace, you have allowed this change in our lives for a purpose. I believe God has spoken to me this morning about how do we handle as a church the stress of change. Now, I want to say again, I've got one finger pointing this way and four back at me. How do we, Devin and I, ever permanent is change. Everything's changing. Science is changing. Technology is changing. That textbook that is being printed today, by the time it gets to the school, is already outdated. Windows 16 and iPhone 10 will be here before we know it. Change is inevitable. Life is just a series of changes. And so Dr. Thomas Holmes developed this chart of 43 changes that we go through in life. And he categorizes them and gives them a number depending on the stress level. The death of a spouse, right at the top. It could be the birth of a baby, somewhere down to graduation, a new job. But each one of those changes bring about some form of stress. That's why I'm convinced this morning the Apostle Paul writes in 2 Corinthians 4, don't get discouraged when these problems and these pressures related to change are happening all around you. I like reading Eugene Peterson's paraphrase of the Bible. Eugene Peterson paraphrases these three verses like this. So we're not giving up. Now, this is first pass. We're not giving up. How could we? Even though on the outside often looks like things are falling apart on us, on the inside, God is doing something new. And not a day goes by without His unfolding grace. These hard times are the small potatoes compared to the good times, the lavish celebration that God has prepared for us. There's far more here than meets the eye. The things we see now are here today, but they're gone tomorrow. But the things we can't see, they're going to last forever. Paul would say we can take everything in life and divide it into two groups. The permanent and the temporal. The visible and the invisible. The things that are only last a while. The things that are going on by forever and ever. The things that are constantly changing and the things that never change. Paul says the things we see around us, even this building, will one day decay and become dust. The house that we're starting to build will one day be a pile of dust. Decay, deteriorate, eventually disappear. But Paul says the things that are invisible in this life are going to last forever. And I think the key for Deb and I to handle stress through these periods of change, and the key for First Baptist Church in handling stress as you're going through this transition period of change, is this: learning to focus on things that last forever. So, how do we normally handle change? Okay? You just got the pink slip, or your wife just gave you notice that she's leaving, or your car just breaks. Anyway, how do we normally, that is, in the flesh as a human being, handle change? Well, first of all, most of us will simply resist it. I'm going to fight against it. I don't want to change. I oppose it. I'm skeptical about it. I don't like change. It kind of reminds you of what are called the Luddites from Nottingham, England in 1811. They were so opposed to change. Any new technological equipment that was built, even in the early 18th century, they were destroying it. And so it's come to mean, if you're here today, you don't like technology, you don't like change, you're called a Luddite. And so sometimes when we're facing change, our response is, you know what, I resist it, I don't want it. And it typically comes out in the Baptist church as, I'm against it. And they're against it because it makes them insecure. So have you ever heard anyone ever say, the pastor, we've never done it that way before? That, my friend, of an insecure person. They're resisting change. But let me just remind you, change is inevitable. If you don't think change is inevitable, go back and pull out your high school annual and then look in the mirror. Go ahead and try to put on that wedding dress again, Or when your child walks in tonight and their pants are like this and they say, "Mama, I need some new clothes for school." Life is about change. It is inevitable. But sometimes we just resist it. Other times we resent it. We cry, we complain, "Why have we got to change that? We've always done it this way before." And you know, that's just, we just complain, resent, resist. Now I'm just kind of give away my age. There might be a few here that remember the old television program Amos and Andy. Okay, there are a few. There was one episode where Amos was asked, you know, how do you handle crisis? How do you cope with it? And Amos' response was quite simple. "I just close my eyes until it goes away." That's how we want to, most of the time, handle change. We resist it. We resent it. But I've noticed the older I get, the more I want security. I like it. I like consistency. I like the comfort zone. I like things on the calendar and fully funded. I don't want any change. I don't know if it's just because I'm getting older, but when we do, we tend to gripe and complain and resist and resent it. How do we handle change? Well, sometimes we just run from it. We just do the 180. And typically, in a Southern Baptist church, you know how that's evidenced? Dwelling on the past. We retreat to the good old days. We talk about, well, back the good old days. And so we shield ourselves from change, of all the things that are happening around us, and we bury our heads in the sand. And I think that's why television reruns are so popular. We like living in the past. Maybe great Little House on the Prairie. Let me just say this. It's not that the past was so good. It's that the unknown of the future is so frightening. I don't think there's a lady in this church that would say, "I'd love to go back to Little House on the Prairie and have to do the laundry out in the creek and join John out in the woods every day." Nobody wants that. It's not that that is so good. It's that the future unknown is so frightening. How do we handle it? Is there anything permanent? Well, yes, there is. God's Word says in Hebrews 13:8, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. The great news is this. I don't know what's going to happen next week. I don't know what next year's First Baptist Church looks like. I do know this. Jesus is already there. Jesus is past, present, and future. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He is eternal. He does not change. I love "Great is Thy Faithfulness," Thomas L. Chisholm's great hymn. In that hymn, he says the following: "Great is Thy faithfulness, O God, my Father." Listen to this. "There is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not. God doesn't change. Thy compassions, they fail not. As Thou hast been, so shalt Thou be. Forever wilt be." Jesus Christ is unchanging. Praise God. When I look at the First Baptist Church's website and purpose statement, number one says, First Baptist Church is Christ-centered. Amen to that. First Baptist Church of Troy, Christ-centered. Christ Jesus, unchangeable, the same yesterday, today, and forever. So if First Baptist Church is going to weather the changing storms over the next year, as you're looking to God for your next pastor, how do you avoid the stress during this process. I am convinced by focusing on these eternal, unchangeable facts. My time has gone very quickly, but let me just give you a couple of these unchangeable, eternal absolutes from God's Word. Number one, God's love for you will never change. Let's remember that. But Pastor Rick, you don't know how I want it. Let me just say this. God's love for you is not dependent upon you keeping His commands. God's choice to love you is His grace. It's only His grace. And there is nothing you can do this morning good to make God love you more. And there is nothing this morning you can do bad to make God love you less. God loves you by His grace. Jeremiah 31, I have loved you with an everlasting love. Again, Peterson says it this way. God told him, I will never quit loving you ever. I don't have time to read it, but Romans chapter 8, just read it. Nothing will ever separate us from God's love. God's love never changes. Number two, God's Word never changes. Again, First Baptist Church website, purpose statement. Number one, Jesus Christ is central. Christ-centered. Number two, biblically based. Praise God for First Baptist Church that you have chosen to say, when we have a question, when we have to make a decision, the number one place we go is not the Constitution, it is not the bylaws, it's God's Word. You say in your website, we are Bible-centered, because God's Word never changes. Psalm 119:89, your Word, O Lord, is eternal. It stands firm. Isaiah 40, the grass withered, the flowers fade, but the Word of God abides forever. First Baptist Church, if you'll anchor your heart and your lives in the Word of God during these changing times, you'll find security when those winds and waves will throw this little church around over the next year. It's God's Word, that never changes. God's love never changes. God's Word never changes. But let me give you another. God's purpose never changes. Do you realize God has a plan? I'll let you in a secret. I read the last chapter. We win, and He's got a plan, and He's orchestrating it. God is sovereign. He's allowing things to happen that I don't like, but they're happening. God has a plan. You know, when I watched the news just this weekend, you start saying, what in the world is this world coming to? And the answer is really simple. The end. God has a plan. And He's bringing it all to a final climax according to His purposes and His ultimate plan. One day very soon, the trumpet of God will sound. The dead in Christ, you and I who know the Lord Jesus Christ, we're going to put on our Easter outfits. We're going to be marching home to the greatest family reunion this world has ever seen. The trumpet will sound and you and I will be with Christ if you know Him today. That is His purpose. That we gather others with us for that great climactic event. And my question this morning, are you ready? As much as the pastor search committee is praying, ultimately, the future of First Baptist Church is in God's hands. Isn't that true? It's in God's hands. And so we put our trust in God's love, in God's will. surrender to His plans and purposes for each one of us. And I don't know what's going to happen this afternoon, more or less next week or next year. But one thing I do know, over the next 7 days, God's going to love me. God's going to love me as much as He's ever loved me in the past. And I know over the next 7 days, 7 months, 7 years, God's Word is going to be just as relevant and just as powerful and just as life-changing and just as equipping and encouraging as it's ever been. And I'm confident that God's purpose for First Baptist Church will not change. Now, my challenge very quickly to First Baptist Church and certainly to Debbie and I as individuals. Listen, change is inevitable. Let's not resist it. Let's not resent it. Let's not try to retreat from it. But let's build our heart and minds, not on these things that are changing and visible, but those invisible, eternal principles of God's will. Very simply, I would say, turn your eyes upon Jesus. Let's look full into His wonderful face. And all the stress of the unknown for First Baptist Church will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory. Heavenly Father, I thank You again for Your incredible Word that provides Ken and I with the kind of hope we need for an unknown future. Father, I thank You for those here this morning at First Baptist that have already placed their faith and trust in You as Savior. Their heart's passion is to know Your will and to obey it. I pray for an ongoing, growing number of men and women who are investing their lives not on the temporal, but on the things that will last forever. Father, it's exciting. It's exciting as we cast these cares of the future. You already know. You know the name and the number of hairs on the head of the next pastor for First Baptist. And for that reason alone, we trust You. We rely on You. We call upon You. We want Your man that You have chosen from eternity past, and that we find and discover Your perfect, pleasing plan for this church. And I want to thank You again for such teachable spirits this morning, those whose lives are willing to pay the calls. We just want to give You thanks. In Jesus' most precious name we pray. Amen. With this time, it's a time of invitation. You respond to this.